welcome to the live radio broadcast of New Baptist Church, located at 610 28th Street in Huntington. You can join us this morning for 11 o'clock service. You could hear the handbells if you come for the 11 o'clock service and join in with that. In our Wednesday evening service, we are not having Awana. Are we having any Wednesday evening service, Robin?
No.
No Wednesday evening service this week. Thanksgiving, traveling to your families and stuff like that. So go see your families this head out Wednesday. And on Sunday days, we just have 11 o'clock service. So will you join us as Carl leads us in prayer?
Good morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the glorious day you blessed us with. We just thank you for the glorious time you give to us that we can come to your house. Our Heavenly Father, as we approach this week, the Lord, that Thanksgiving comes, and we just want to stop and bow our heads and thank you, Lord, for the many blessings you bestowed upon us this year. Just give you all the thanks and the glory, Lord, because we know not through you that we will not be able to give thanks and glorify your name. Our Heavenly Father, just bless each one that's here this morning. Bless our special music this morning. Bless Pastor Robbins, who brings a message. To everything to do, Lord, glorify your name. Our Heavenly Father, just bless the service at 11 o'clock with Pastor Trent, that if there's some lost soul in our congregation, we'll know you as our personal Savior. Our Heavenly Father, just bless us and guide us as we watch over us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Carl. Our special music this morning is quite busy. She's singing solo today, and she's also part of the bell choir. So Nina is going to sing. Okay. And what grade are you in, 7th or 8th?
7th.
She's in 7th grade. So thank you, Nina.
Were creation suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry, then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return to glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, but my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified in the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Thank you so much, Nina. And you are showing Christ magnified in you already. Just such a young soul with so much love for everyone and shares the gospel with people. Thank you. Our message this morning is Pastor Robin.
Well, we thank you and welcome again to the Radio Bible Class of New Baptist Church. I am Robinb Crouch, one of the pastors here. And again, we thank you for joining us. And with Sherry, let me give you an invitation to join us for our in-person worship. That's at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. Or you can also join us by way of our live stream. Again, you can find links to that on our church website at newbaptistchurch.com. We also archive our Sunday morning services as well as this radio Bible class on our church YouTube page. So you can find past lessons, past Sunday morning services right there. You can go, again, a link on our church website. Today, we continue our series of lessons in the Ten Commandments. We come to the sixth. God has spoken clearly in this commandment. It's short and to the point. So if you have your copy of God's Word, you can open it with me to Exodus chapter 20. One short verse. Verse 13, King James says it this way, thou shalt not kill. Or, if you have a modern translation, it may read, you shall not murder. Pray with me. Our Father, I give you thanks for the morning. I thank you for the opportunity we have to gather around your word. And I pray you would teach us from it. Lord, I thank you that in the depth of your teaching of your word, there are many layers, and with the Ten Commandments, you certainly have given us those layers. God, help us to listen intently to hear what you have for us. Open our eyes and ears to see and to hear, our hearts to understand. And then, oh God, give us courage in our wills to obey you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you shall not murder. The word there, murder or kill, is In the original language, means manslayer. So murder is the intent of this. Now, some have tried to stretch this commandment to animals we kill for food or as a rebuke of war. Both are dealt with in other places of the scripture. But here in the Ten Commandments, the intent is murder. Our society demonstrates each day that we are far from God when it comes to this. What he values, we devalue. You see, to God, life is precious and of great value, but not so to us. It doesn't take but a quick glance at our world to see that life is cheap. Job place killings, drive-by shootings that kill the innocent, schoolyard shootings, abortion and assisted suicide. Too often we read of newborns being left for dead in garbage bags or in trash bins. We read of senseless murders nearly every day. And then we see aggression on the national level, like we saw on October 7th in Israel. But just consider the following. In the United States, here, let's talk about our country. Two people are murdered every hour, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. That's over 17,000 deaths a year. There are 30,000 suicides every year in America. National Right to Life reports based on numbers provided by the CDC and the Guttmacher Institute that since 1973, an estimated 64 million unborn babies have been killed in America. We are aborting babies in America at the rate of a million per year, nearly a million. Now that's 2,800 times every day. A little unborn baby is aborted by his or her mother. In this country, there's more protection by law for snails in a river than for an unborn baby in the womb of its mother. So before we say, I've got this one, let's move on because we need to take another look. You may say, I've never killed anybody. I've not done any of the things you've talked about. But before we say, I've got it, let's take a deeper look at what God has to say to us here in this passage. To understand the commandment, we must first examine its basis. And that is this, that all life is a gift from God. Scripture reveals to us that God watches over all life. From vegetation to birds to animals to mankind, all life comes from God. But there is a hierarchy. And human life is more special to God because humans are made in God's image. Our life bears the image of God. Let me illustrate it this way. You know, the value of money does not come from the sum of the value of the component parts, but rather from the image with which it is stamped. You see, a $10 bill's value does not come from the value of the paper and ink, but rather it comes from the image of the seal of the United States of America. That's where it gets its value, the image with which it's sealed. We are created in God's image. Our lives are valuable because they carry God's image. From the womb to tomb, we bear God's image, and that's sacred and valuable. Here's a principle for you. All life is sacred and has value. But all life is not holy or divine, but all life does come from God. It's sacred because its source is God. Now that principle carries some implications. If it comes from God, then life belongs to God. If it belongs to God, then he has the right to control it. Therefore, because he gives it, because it bears his image, God gives a commandment that speaks to its value and to the consequence of taking it on your own. Now, what's the meaning of this commandment? Well, in examining this commandment, it's important to know both what it doesn't mean and what it does mean. So let's look first at what it does not mean. The word is murder. and refers specifically to human life. So it doesn't apply to the killing of animals. Now, in Exodus chapter 20, just a few more verses down, it says this, "An altar of earth you shall make for me, and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and your peace offerings, your sheep and your oxen." Now, I'm not advocating for the senseless killing and slaughter of animals. Those who would torture or abuse animals are sick and they need help. There are other scriptural principles that apply to the treatment of animals, but it's not this commandment. It also does not mean accidental killing. It is not about accidents that happen. Now, there are consequences within our own culture if you are responsible for an accident that kills someone. But that's not breaking this commandment. This is about murder. It's about intentional killing. It also is not about capital punishment by the government. Exodus 21:12 says this, "Whoever strikes a man so that he dies shall be put to death." Capital punishment is in the hands of the government, not individuals. But this commandment is not speaking toward that. Now, some would disagree with me there, and that's okay. I think there are other principles we can apply, but not just this one. It does not mean killing in self-defense, at home, or for nations at war. Exodus 22:2 says this, "If a thief is found breaking in and is struck so that he dies, there should be no blood guilt for him." Self-defense is not breaking this commandment. So it does not mean killing of animals, does not mean accidental killing, does not mean capital punishment, does not mean killing in self-defense. So what does it mean? Well, first it means homicide. The willful taking of a life. In 2021, the CDC reported over 26,000 people murdered in the U.S. Now, to put that in perspective, since 2001, in all of the post-9/11 wars, the U.S. has had over 7,000 deaths. Now, that is a total for over 20 years, 7,000. And we had nearly four times that in murders in the U.S. in 2021. But most of us here listening this morning have not committed murder. The government is called to mete out punishment, but we as individuals are called to avoid meting out punishment. It's not our job, that's the government's job. It does mean homicide. It also means, in my opinion, infanticide and euthanasia. Some people believe these are issues of choice. Well, honestly, they are. But it's God's choice and not ours. See, the taking of a life in the womb is wrong, and the assisting of death of the aged is sick and also wrong. I'm not speaking here of prolonging life artificially, where machines are sustaining life apart from brain activity. Some will ask, what's the difference between this and capital punishment? Well, the difference is innocence and guilt. So it does mean homicide. It does mean, I believe, infanticide, killing of infants, babies, euthanasia, We call it doctor or physician-assisted suicide. But it also does also mean suicide. It's in epidemic proportions. According to the CDC, 49,000 people in the U.S. in 2022 committed suicide. It's the third leading cause of death among 15 to 24-year-olds after accidental deaths and murders. Permanent solution. I read the other day from a friend of mine who he works in a hospital. He's former military, former police, and he works in a hospital that gives mental health help to first responders, to military. And I saw him writing the other day where, in his own words, he said he knew what it meant to feel like the world would be a better place without you, not being able to deal with the demons inside. And then he said this, and we've all heard it. He said, "I was looking for a permanent solution to a temporary problem." And then he encourages the first responders to get help. It's there and it's available. Proud of the man he's become, overcoming his own personal addictions and issues he had, and now offering help to first responders. You see, for me, suicide is a senseless, foolish act, the ultimate act of selfishness. People think that it won't hurt anybody but themselves, and I will tell you, families are devastated. Friends are devastated. It affects far, far more than what you think. So that's what it means. Homicide. Infanticide, euthanasia, willful taking of life. Suicide. So what does Jesus have to say about this? Well, much like people in Jesus' day, we think because we've never murdered anyone, we've kept the commandment. It's to this kind of pride that Jesus spoke. In Matthew 5, the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus addresses the people knowing their pride and their real needs. He understands that they try to keep the law as a checklist and feel pretty good about their own righteousness. You know, I've done this, and I didn't do this, and I've checked it all off, and we see... our lives with God more as a checklist than we do as a relationship. And Jesus then begins to interpret the law for them in terms that brings it home and shows them how affected we are by it. He expands the law this way. And you've read it. As you read that, he says it this way. "You have heard it said," he begins, and then he recalls one of the commandments, and he introduces his explanation and directive for them by saying this, "But I say to you," in verse 21 of chapter 5, the following, he gives his explanation and expansion of this commandment. He says this, "You have heard it said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable of judgment. But I say to you, everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire." Did you catch that? Anger or hatred toward one another. You have murdered them in your heart. Just how many of us said, "I hate you"? How many of us wish someone would die? Do you seek your own revenge? Name-calling with contempt. It's character assassination. This one gets us all. I've seen parents go off on their children, calling them stupid and fools, and those are the most polite of the names they've used. Children toward parents, disrespect. Employees toward bosses and vice versa, bosses toward employees. In arguments, we say some awful things. And see here, Jesus says that God takes seriously how you talk to and about people. We all find ourselves guilty here sometime, don't we? And Jesus, though, did not leave us without a solution. He says, go and make it right with your brother or sister. Jesus said, do these things before you come to the altar and bring your with your offerings. Do it before. Get it done. Do it before you come to the altar with your offerings. This is immediate confession and seeking of forgiveness. It's also offering that forgiveness. Matthew chapter 15, Jesus says this way, for out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile anyone. It is that concealed murder that gets most of us, isn't it? It is that where we are angry with someone, where we badmouth someone. And Jesus said, well, you've heard it said, but I say to you. So where does that put us with this? Well, Jesus has provided forgiveness for us. God has in Jesus Christ. There may be someone listening today who's committed murder, whether outwardly or within their own heart. But see, God loved us enough to provide forgiveness for all sinners, including murderers, me and you. That provision was made when Jesus died and was nailed on a cross. He died to forgive sin, not just the sins of some, but for the sins of all. And this morning, I would say to you, if you've never asked God to forgive you, what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Why not come today and receive forgiveness? Forgiveness of sin. Why not go to the Father who loves you? But for those of us who are followers of Christ, what about our attitudes? You have some confession to make? You have some people you need to go to and apologize and ask forgiveness? Have some relationships that need to be repaired? Remember what Jesus said. You've heard it said, you shall not murder. But I say to you, if you speak evil, speak bad, if you get mad, if you get angry, you've murdered him in your heart. Let's make it right. Jesus said, make it right. Go to your brother and sister before you come to the altar with your sacrifices, with your offerings. Pray with me. Father, I give you thanks for again for your word, for how pointed it is, and oh God, how it teaches us how to live. Oh Lord, help us to see what Jesus says and to live in a way that points people to him and builds relationships. Oh God, thank you. Now let us walk that way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.